Okay, good morning. How are you today? Everything is okay? So any questions from last time? Any questions, any confusion, any problems? So I think I had some problem last time. I think in lymphadenopathy, I think I said swelling of adrenal glands, but it is swelling of lymph nodes. That is where I think I had done this mistake, but I could not review it because it is still not loaded. So, but if still there is some problem when I speak, and sometimes, you know, the ideas go back and forth, if there is some problem, you get confused. And what I say is, if it is different than what is in the handouts, just please do not hesitate and just let me know, because it happens. So if there is no question from the last time, we will straightway go to the next one. And here is some mechanism of action of some drugs, anti-trypanosomal drugs. So one, suramine, that inhibits glycolytic enzymes. You know glycolytic pathways that produces ATP from glucose. So suramine inhibits glycolytic enzymes. Next one is malarespiral. It's similar to suramine, and it also inhibits enzymes of glycolytic pathway. Other is pentamidine. It binds to mitochondrial DNA of trypanosomes and disrupts its function. So that was some of the drugs that are used for the treatment of trypanosoma. So one thing I clarify, there are certain tables, and there are a lot of symptoms, diarrhea, dysentery, and, you know, this feeling, that feeling, weariness, lassitude, and all those things. You know, you don't have to memorize everything exactly the way it is written. The idea is to give you a feeling that if brain is directly targeted, what type of pain it gives. And when it senses the pain from the liver or from kidney or from other organ, other system, what type of pain it feels. So that you have to little bit use your common sense rather than directly memorizing everything what is in the table, right? Because brain is the ultimate sensor, and it has few warnings, few types of language it recognizes. If the pain is in the liver, it might have similar feelings or pains when it is itself sometimes targeted. So those things you have to understand. And plus symptoms, what type of symptoms are in the disease process, what are the organelles affected, what are the diagnostic tools are, what is epidemiology is, from where the person came, what area he traveled. So combined with all these three, four things, you can judge, okay, here is the disease. You cannot judge based on the pains, weariness, and tiredness, because some people feel tired all the time. So it doesn't mean that he is affected by a parasite or he is having a disease process. So rather than, you know, memorizing the tables exactly as it is written, you have to feel, you have to sense what type of, you know, is combined with other things, epidemiology, morphology of the organism, diagnostic tools. So together that will give the picture what type of disease it is or what parasite it is. And that is what in the exams will be asked. Not like, you know, exactly narrate what is in the tables. And of course, the handout, that is ultimate. Nothing will be beyond what is in the handouts. That is the first and the last. What I'm speaking here, sometimes it is more, sometimes more explanatory, just for your understanding. So next one is trypanosomiasis, American trypanosomiasis. This is caused by Trypanosoma cruzi, and the geographical distribution is South America and Central America. The organism, as I said, is Trypanosoma cruzi. It has three forms. This is epimastigote form that is found in insects. You don't have to worry about this because you'll not be able to see it, because it is only found in the insects, vectors. This is trypomastigote form. Once the parasite enters into the bloodstream, it converts itself into trypomastigote form. It is found in the blood, Trypanosoma cruzi, blood form, and it is very similar to Trypanosoma brucei. They morphologically they are similar. So in the blood, you will not be able to distinguish whether it is Trypanosoma brucei or Trypanosoma cruzi, right? So Trypanosoma brucei was African trypanosomiasis, right? And this is American trypanosomiasis. But this American trypanosomiasis, it also affects some organs. And in the tissue, it is found in the amastigote form. This is called pseudocyst form. It is spherical, it is pseudocyst form. It doesn't have any cyst wall, but it is spherical, and it is also called Lissmanial form, okay? So Trypanosoma cruzi, it is found in the blood as well as in the tissues, and in the tissue, it exists in this form that is called pseudocyst form or Lissmanial form or amastigote form. So the reservoir in this case is wild animals, armadillo, opossum, raccoon, dog, cat, and other animals. So these are the reservoirs. The vector is cone nose bug. It's also called kissing bug. And this is the vector. It infects the human beings. So the cycle is in the vector, and in the vector, and in the human beings. It is, the disease is associated with poor living condition, thatched, and walls not well maintained, and that is where insects can live. So this insect does not fly. It is also called Trichoma sordida, Trichoma infestans. There are various names: Panstrongelis magistus, Rhodinius prolixia. These are various names. But I think you'll be fine if you just remember kissing bug or cone nose bug. Then nose is cone, so it's cone nose bug. Or maybe Trichoma also. So this is the vector for Trypanosoma cruzi. And the way it infects is, it's very funny because it doesn't fly, it just crawl. And the people who are sleeping on the floor, it finds the facial part. And then it just bites there. It infects, bites there. And at the same place, it defecates. So the wild parasite in the fecus material, and because that the wound is there, and fecal material is there, and sometimes people just wipe it out because this pain of, you know, biting, and the parasite enters through the insect bite. So this is a, you know, and exactly at the same time defecates when it bites. So this is another way of impolite kissing. So again here, Trypanosoma cruzi, it is also called Chagas disease. And the organs are the skin, that is first place, biting place. And at that place, there will be some swelling that is without pus. This is called non-purulent edematous swelling, and it's plaque. So that will be the first place where there will be symptoms. And then acute stage, when the parasite enters into the bloodstream, then it goes to the lymph node and heart, and there it will lead to malaise, restlessness, lymphadenitis, inflammation of lymph nodes, hepatomegaly, if it goes to the liver, splenomegaly, swelling of spleen, acute myocarditis, swelling of heart, and generalized edema. So that was acute stage. And in chronic stage, hollow organs are affected, such as esophagus. It becomes megaesophagus. Colon, it becomes megacolon. Cardiomegaly and cardiac arrhythmia. So this is one of the symptoms of Trypanosoma cruzi infection, American trypanosomiasis called Chagas disease, and edema, swelling of the face. This is colon, swelling of the colon. What happens? The parasite infects the nervous system. It destroys the autonomous nervous system, and nervous system, it does not work, so there won't be peristaltic movement in the digestive system, and it will be swollen because peristaltic movement will not be there. Autonomous nervous system is destroyed by the parasite. Sometimes there will be problem of swelling. People eat, they cannot swell because swelling is because of peristaltic movement of esophagus. So that is one of the symptoms of, and sometimes people say that, you know, if you have Chagas disease, just jump down so that you can, you know, ingest your food material. So that is one of the problems of Chagas disease. This is a megacolon, colon, swelling colon, because peristaltic movement is affected. This is swelling the heart by X-ray and by this picture. So in the blood, you can see the parasite like this, similar to Trypanosoma brucei. It is very difficult to differentiate between brucei and clusii when it is in the blood. Pathology is direct inflammatory response, because when the parasite is in the blood, it will lead to inflammation, direct inflammatory response. And Chaga toxin is released. Chaga toxin is glycoprotein, and that is released by the parasite, and that causes harm to the host. Damage to the infected cells, if the parasite is in the organ, so that damage will be to the infected cells, depending where the parasite is. And as I said, destruction of the autonomic nerve ganglions, and that is why the peristaltic movement is affected. And products of humoral and CMI, cell-mediated immunity, that is also they cause some of the harm, because the parasite induces humoral and cell-mediated immunity, and some of the harmful effects could be because of these immunity effects. Antibody kills but does not eradicate clusii. Cell-mediated immunity is some protective value. And activation of macrophages kill the organism. Immunosuppression, if they are not able to kill the organism, then that leads to immunosuppression. So these are immunological responses. In most of the parasites, it is yes or no, whether there is immunological protection. 99.9% you'll have to use the drug. But sometimes, such as, you know, this, if there is continuous infection many times, it was subsidized, and then again there was, you know, many times, then there might be immunological protection. But assume that you'll have to use the drug to kill the parasite. So when a person is infected by Chagas disease, first thing you'll have to ask, what is the history of the travel? And if he has cardiac problems, and there'll be Romamna signs or Chagoma, swelling of the face, just in the beginning the picture I showed you. And organisms in the Chagoma exudate. So the diagnostic tools here will be exudate of a lymph node or aspirate or the blood, depending upon the organs. If it is in the organ, then you can see parasite, that trypomastigote form. And if it is in the lymph node, then you will see the pseudocyst or leishmanial form, that is spherical structure. So here, this is bioassay in mice. What is done is sometimes if the parasite number is very less, the blood is injected into the mice, and then mice, they develop, the parasite multiplies in the blood of mice, and you take out the blood of the mice, and then you can detect the parasite in the blood. Another way is there are certain laboratories, they keep this kissing bug uninfected, and the person is allowed, you know, these bugs, they are taken to the person who is infected, and the bugs, they bite, and then they are infected, and after a few days, they become infected, these kissing bugs. And in their fecal material, you can detect the parasite. So these are few bioassays for detecting or diagnosing Chagas disease. It's a very dangerous disease because it not only affects the person who is infected, sometimes if you give the blood, or the organ, if you are organ donor after not use somebody's organ donor, heart, liver, so that way it can lead to the person who is getting the heart recipient. So there are various ways it not only affects the person who is infected, but the other persons also can be affected, right? Because sometimes, you know, some accident is there and somebody has died. And he's a good candidate for heart donation. But you don't know the history of the person because he's dead, he's cadaver. He will not tell where he had visited. And if you take out the heart, then the heart is contaminated or is infected with the parasite. And that parasite will enter into the recipient, and that it will have all the signs of sarcoma disease, swelling of the cardiac heart. And the death will be because of the parasite, not because of the rejection of the heart. So these things, and that is why when Red Cross, when you go to donate the blood, they will ask you, have you visited the South American countries, or ever have you been infected with or affected by Chagas disease? So this is why, you know, we have to be more careful about this Chagas disease, because it affects Americans itself. So this is the case for Chagas disease. I have included few cases just for your general idea. In July 1998, the mother of an 18-month-old boy in rural Tennessee found a tritomine bug in his crib, which she saved because it resembled a bug shown on TV program about insects that prey on mammals. So a few days ago, she had seen that bug, kissing bug on TV, and she remembered this is the same bug, and she saved. Okay, the gut content of the bug was found by light microscopy and PCR. So PCR is a technique which is clearly identifies some genes of the parasite. So it's quite a sure shot detection of the parasite, and by PCR to be infected with Trypanosoma cruzi. Blood specimens obtained from child in July and August were negative by microscopy, and hemoculture positive by PCR and DNA hybridization. This is also a nucleic acid technique, suggesting a low level of parasitemia. Low level of parasites was present in the blood. The specimens obtained after benzanidazole treatment were negative. He did not develop anti-cruzi antibody. 19 relatives and neighbors also were zero negative. 2 of 3 raccoons trapped in the vicinity had positive hemocultures for Trypanosoma cruzi. So this shows the history. Raccoons, they are the reservoirs, and the kissing bug was found, and the boy, he was infected. He had some antibodies against the Trypanosoma cruzi, and by PCR also. So another one, Trypanosoma cruzi in transplant recipients. So when there is a transplant cases. Case 1, in December 2005, a man aged 64 years received a heart transplant. In February 2006, he was readmitted to the hospital with anorexia, eating disorder, fever, and diarrhea for 2 weeks duration. Trypanosoma cruzi was seen in both blood and biopsy from the heart. The patient had no identifiable risk factors for Trypanosoma cruzi infection, traveled to a country endemic of Chagas disease. He was seronegative for Trypanosoma cruzi antibodies, but positive for Trypanosoma cruzi DNA by polymerase chain reaction. After initiation of nifurtimox therapy, his parasites rapidly cleared. However, in April 2006, the patient died from complications attributed to acute rejection of the transplanted organs. The source of infection tracked the organ donor who tested seropositive for Trypanosoma cruzi antibodies by RIPA, radio immunoprecipitation assay, and tested borderline positive by IFA. So these are diagnostic techniques, IFA, immunofluorescence antibody. He had been born in the US but had traveled to Trypanosoma cruzi endemic area of Mexico. So these are some cases. The recipient, he did not die because reaction, but because he was infected by cruzi parasite because of donor heart from the infected person. Case number two, this is similar, you can read it. The idea here is that once a recipient is taking some organ from other person, so the other person should be tested, and you should know the history of the travel history of that person, whether he was tested for all these, you know, Shagoma disease, presence of parasites, and immunological testing. So the treatment, prevention and treatment of Chagas disease. Nifurtimox, effective in acute stage. These are the drug for the Shagoma prevention and treatment. Sometimes these, prevention, these drugs, they treat also. And before, you know, some infection happens, if you take them, they are preventive also. So if you travel to some countries, you know, if you take these preventive medicines, they will prevent the infection. Benzenidazole may be of value in chronic stage, and of course the best treatment is avoid and control the insect population. There is no vaccine. So kissing bug, remember kissing bug, and it could be very dangerous. And the way it bites, it's more dangerous. You know, that is a rare case that it bites also and defecates also. And the infection is because of the fecal material, presence of the parasite in the fecal material. What you'll do, just wherever it bites, it does like this because of the, you know, pain little bit. And then that will be more dangerous because wherever it had to bitten, the parasite will be spread everywhere. And there will be next few days, there will be swelling Chagoma. And if untreated, that will lead to further complications in spleen and other organs. So the mechanism of action, how Nifurtimox works, it generates cytotoxic superoxide anion. And this anion is very toxic to the parasite. Cytotoxic superoxide. These anions are very toxic to the parasites, and that is how they die with this medicine. And benzenidazole, it is protein and RNA synthesis inhibitor. It prevents the synthesis of proteins and RNA, and these parasites, they are very sensitive to benzenidazole, and that is why they cannot survive. Okay, so that was Trypanosoma cruzi. So Trypanosoma cruzi and Trypanosoma brucei. Cruzi is American trypanosomiasis. Brucei is African trypanosomiasis. In brucei, you have two forms, Gambians and Rhodesians. In long term, they have similar symptoms. But in Gambians, that symptoms are because of brain infection, brain sleeping sickness. And in Rhodesians, think Rhodesians because of heart failure. Just check it in your notes. I think I may be right. But you check your notes, because in Gambians and in Rhodesians, symptoms are similar. One is very fast, that the disease happens faster, 6 to 9 months, and the patient dies because of heart failure. In another one, it is because of sleeping sickness. Initially, the symptoms are similar. I think in Gambians, it is sleeping sickness, and in Rhodesians, it is heart failure. But initial symptoms are similar. And the vectors are different in both cases. So that was trypanosoma, both African trypanosomiasis and the American trypanosomiasis. Now let us move ahead with leishmaniasis. So in leishmaniasis, there are epidemic first geographical distribution. There are three forms of leishmaniasis. Let's start from here, visceral leishmaniasis. This is the most dangerous form, visceral. Visceral leishmaniasis, this is found mostly in Asia. Second is cutaneous leishmaniasis. That is mostly in Middle East and Mediterranean countries. During Iraq war, army personnel who had working in Iraq, when they came back here, they were affected by cutaneous leishmaniasis. And mucocutaneous, that is in the central America, Central and South America. So three farms amongst this, the most dangerous is visceral farm, and these two are also could be disfiguring to the skin. So the organisms, Leishmania donovani, that causes visceral leishmaniasis, found in Asia, 10 million people affected. A lot of people are affected by Leishmania donovani. And this is the most dangerous form. Leishmania tropica, that causes cutaneous leishmaniasis and found mostly in Mediterranean, 5 million people, and Middle East also, Iraq. That was the source of infection for some American troops. When they came here, they were affected by this Leishmania tropica. And the third is Leishmania brasiliensis. It causes mucocutaneous infection. And it is according to the name of the country where it is found. It could be Mexicana, or it could be depending on the South American country, their names. That is how it is. Leishmania brasiliensis, one of them. And South and Central America, 10 million people. So as I said, the infection 2003 because of army personnel working in Kuwait or Afghanistan, or so they came here and they were affected by cutaneous leishmaniasis. Morphology, it has two forms. One is amastigote form and the promastigote form. Amastigote form, that is found in the mammalian host, and promastigote form, that is found in sandfly. This one, sandfly is a vector for Leishmania. So amastigote form, it is just like similar to Trypanosoma cruzi, right? Trypanosoma cruzi, and this Leishmania morphology, that amastigote form is similar. It's very difficult to differentiate between the two. Trypanosoma cruzi, amastigote form, that is found in the tissues, and the Leishmania amastigote form, that is the infective form, infective stage of Leishmania. The promastigote form, that is found in the insects, you will not be able to see them, you will not be able to encounter them, so don't worry about these forms. Just the one which you can find in the patients, that is what you have to recognize them. And if you are given a picture, what is this? You have to be able to find out. Okay, this is Leishmania or Trypanosoma cruzi. Then the next, what are the symptoms? What are the organs affected? Combined with three or four circumstantial evidences, you will be able to figure out exactly whether it is Leishmania or Trypanosoma cruzi, right? But sometimes you might be befooled by Trypanosoma brucei and cruzi in the blood form, because in the blood, they look very similar, until unless, and in, brucei is most in the blood. Cruzi, that also infects tissues, and that is where it has amastigote form. So it will never be that, you know, we'll ask a question, okay, exactly this morphology and what is the disease. Always in parasites, there can't be only one thing. There has to be combined things that you can say, okay, it is this parasite. And the maximum, the ultimate objective is to have the diagnostic tool and identify the organism. That is the main culprit. So in Leishmania, the life cycle is here, human, and in sandfly, and they are these dogs and wild animals, they are all the secondary host. No, sorry, they are animal reservoirs, and sandfly is a vector, and humans, they are affected by they are bitten by these vectors, and that is how they transmit the parasite into human beings, Leishmania. So sandfly, this is how it looks, and this is how, when it bites, it just infects and transmits the parasite in the bloodstream of the humans. Leishmania symptoms, in visceral leishmaniasis, organs involved, they are liver, spleen, bone marrow, lymph nodes, and skin. Symptoms, In this case, at the site of the bite, there is no bite reaction. And then parasite, if it enters into lymph nodes, it will cause lymphadenopathy. If it goes to the spleens, it will cause swelling of spleen, splenomegaly. If it goes to the liver, hepatomegaly. And if it is in the blood, it will cause parasitemia, parasites in the blood. And when the parasite is in the blood, that will lead to chills, cold, feeling cold and fever, chills and fevers, darkening of the skin. So that is one of the, that is one of the peculiar signs of visceral leishmaniasis. That is why it is called Kala-Azar, black disease. Kala-Azar, the patient becomes black, the skin becomes blackening, and that is called darkening of the skin, Kala-Azar. And in the cutaneous type, the skin is the target, and there is centrifugally growing papular lesions, small micropapules, vesicles, small vesicles, and they contain pus. Okay. Central crusting, it becomes dried, and then afterwards heals sometimes spontaneously, but it leaves a permanent scar. The place where the bite was, you know, that place, it becomes disfiguring. It's unpleasant to watch because of the encrusting of the skin and presence of micropapules with pus. The whole thing becomes very ugly, and it leaves permanent scar where the sandfly had bitten. And the third one is mucocutaneous. It is similar to cutaneous form, but it also spreads to mucoid tissues, such as mucosa, nasal mucosa, or oral mucosa. So initially same as cutaneous lesions, but it does not heal. Necrosis of the mucoid tissue. There is necrosis of mucoid tissue. Sometimes nasal bridge, it is destroyed. Or mucosa, the oral mucosa, that is destroyed. Necrosis of the mucoid tissue, metastasis to distant mucoid tissues, a very disfiguring. I'll show you the picture. You know, from this table it looks not that bad, but if you see the picture, they are really bad. One has to be careful. Okay, so this is visceral leishmaniasis. This is a case from Asia. In bordering to sea areas, a lot of countries, they have more than 30-40% people affected by this visceral leishmaniasis. Kala-Azar, blackening of the skin. You don't have to see this. Whole skin becomes black. Okay, and swelling because visceral organs, they are affected. Progressive, so 1 to 4 months, it takes 4 months for the infection to show the symptoms. Fever and chills, because the parasite in the blood, fever and chills. Diarrhea and dysentery, because it also affects visceral organs, so there will be diarrhea and dysentery. Progressive hepatosplenomegaly, after a few months, there will be swelling in the liver and spleens. Skin hyperpigmentation, that is what I said, black disease, Kala-Azar. Death if untreated, person will die if it untreated. So here is a case of visceral leishmaniasis. Patient A, fever 104 Fahrenheit. It can lead to fever also because parasite enters into the bloodstream. Was first noted by patient A in late December 2003, and rigors, shaking, flushing, redness, sweating, mild orthostasis, composure cannot stand properly. In early January 2004, and lost 13 pounds body weight, you know, losing of weight. That is one of the signs of visceral leishmaniasis. Visceral leishmaniasis was suspected, but no leishmanial parasites were noted in light microscopy examination. Generally, what happens by the time you take the blood, the leishmania had gone somewhere else. So that is one of the problems. It has entered in the spleen or in the liver. So you are looking in the blood and he's somewhere else. So that is one of the problems in visceral leishmaniasis. And no leishmanian DNA was detected by genus-specific PCR reaction. The findings in splenic enlargement suggested when it was in the spleen suggested, and surgical splenectomy was considered briefly. In February 2004, because of continuing concern that patient had visceral ischemiasis, the liver biopsy specimen was re-examined by light microscopy. One definite and multiple probable leishmanial parasites were noted. So sometimes you have to go after, chase the parasite where it is, rather than just go for the blood. Blood is not for every, is not diagnostic tool for everything. It could be helpful if you find it there, but if not, then it could be befooling also, and the patient may die if you are looking in the blood sometimes. So you have to go, liver or somewhere, other targets of the parasite, leishmania. And this is a patient B. You can edit it by yourself. See, this is cutaneous leishmaniasis. So that was visceral leishmaniasis. And this is cutaneous leishmaniasis. See, small, this is pus, small vesicles. They're called papules, micropapules. And after a few weeks, they dry. It's called encrusting. They dry. And they leave a permanent scar. You have to undergo surgery, skin surgery, something, to correct it. Normally, it will not be correct. It will be there just like this. And the second case is here, right? So if the insect bites and you get something like this, so it could be cutaneous leishmaniasis. Right, if I show you this picture in your exam, I give you this picture, you don't need any other evidence. This is final evidence, okay? It has to be leishmaniasis cutaneous, right? Cutaneous leishmaniasis. And this is mucocutaneous leishmaniasis. So if the parasite, in this case, the parasite also goes to the mucosa tissue, lining of the oral and nasal mucosa, and there it is also disfiguring and collapse of the nasal bridge. And here, because of oral mucosa, it's also disfiguring. So that is, this is mucocutaneous leishmaniasis. So what you need for the diagnosis, first thing you have to see what is the history of travel, and where did he go? Because all these three leishmania diseases, they are found in particular areas. Asia is visceral leishmaniasis. Middle East and Mediterranean countries, they have cutaneous. And South and Central America, they have mucocutaneous leishmaniasis. So if the travel and if there is a skin infection and mucosa infection and visceral infection combined with the travel history and the blood smears, blood, the parasite is in the blood, or for this mucocutaneous and cutaneous, you have to take the swab of the place where the encrusting areas underneath the encrust are the micropapules, exudates of the micropapules. So the parasite will be there. You can find the parasite at that site of infection. So if all these things they give, okay, this is leishmanial, pseudocyst form, and then you can say, okay, this is a leishmanial infection. So travel history and diagnostic tools. So diagnostic tools for three leishmania, blood and the organs, you have to check. Cutaneous one, you have to encrusted areas. And mucocutaneous also in mucosal tissues, you have to take out the samples, swabs from there. And then you have to find out whether parasite is there or not. The parasite will look like a pseudocyst. There is no cell wall. It's a spherical structure. A mastigote form. And the lesions are symptoms. At the site whether lesions are not, at the site of the bite, organism in the lesion, you find the organism, the lesions are not cutaneous form, but in visceral and all those, you have to check in the blood and organs affected. Montenegro test, this is a type 4 hypersensitivity test. This is a place in Romania, that is where this test was discovered, first time they found out. So here they use antibodies of this leishmania, and by antibody test, by I think injecting in the skin, they can find out whether the infection was because of leishmania. They have specific antibodies, and that gives type 4 hypersensitivity when injected in the skin. So Montenegro test, that is one of the best tests for the Leishmanian infections. So this is how you will find the Leishmania. See, this is in the macrophages and the bone marrow. When it goes into the blood, that it directly it enters in the macrophages. And in the macrophages, if you stain it, the pseudocysts, they are present. And if it enters into the bone marrow, in bone marrow also you can see the Leishmanian form. Right? So pathogenesis and immunology. So damage is mostly because of cell-mediated immunity. So as I said, Leishmania, the one which is, it goes into the organs and the cells, macrophages. So damage is due to cell-mediated immunity. It causes damage to the cells. And it has proteoglycans. That's called Leishmanian proteoglycans, surface glycoproteins. They are toxic. And that is how also it causes the injury to the cells. Leukopenia, decrease in number of leukocytes and increase in number of monocytes and lymphocytes. That is what you'll find if you take the blood picture. Less leukocytes and more monocytes and lymphocytes, because when there is infection, monocytes and lymphocytes, their number increases in most of the infections. Bacterial infections as well as parasitic infections if they are in the blood. And immunosuppression. So secondary effect of all these immunological reactions is, initially they try to destroy the parasite. But at later stage, what happens, there is immunosuppression itself. That is the side effect of the immunological reactions. I'm not an expert of immunology, but that is what I have read. And I don't understand the chemistry, biochemistry part of it. So the interferon and TNF alpha. Interferons, if the patient, at least in animal models, it has been shown that interferon and TNF-alpha, they have protective value against Leishmania infections. There's no vaccine, as I said, there's no vaccine for the parasites. These parasites has to be chased. You have to find them wherever they are. And based on the symptoms, based on the behavior of the person, you can suspect, but ultimately is to find them and see whether they really are. Control of the vectors, because one of the major infection sources is vectors, sandfly. Control of these vectors, kill them. And infected animals, dogs and all those, dogs are the main problems in this. And in most of the developing countries, stray dogs, unclaimed dogs are everywhere, you know, in marketplaces. And if they carry, they are the reservoirs, you know. And combined with the vector, it's a very rich area, it's fertile area for the infection, okay. Dogs, sandflies, and then this infection. Avoid sandfly, of course, if sandfly cannot bite you, then, but that's very difficult because, you know, sandfly will find you. That is, they have to look for their food, you know. So instead of in addition to taking their own food, they will infect you with the parasite, okay? So the best is preventive medicine is take some preventive medicines to avoid infection. When you travel into these areas, Asia, bordering to the sea areas, and Iraq, Mediterranean countries, and Middle East countries, and South and Central of America, when you travel to these places, I think the best thing is, best medicine is to carry some medicine which has preventive medicines rather than curative. When it happens, then you have to think for hundreds of things whether it was this and, you know, then it's a really a problem. Preventive is the best. Prevention is the best treatment. Pentosan is the drug which is used for the treatment. It is antimony gluconate compound. Okay, so I think this was the first part. What I'll do is I'll give you a break, and then we will finish the next part. What I'll do is I'll move a little faster, and in the next class, I'll repeat most of the very important ones so that you are not left confused. very clear cut, okay, this is what you have to study. It could be very confusing, I'm telling you. It could be so confusing that you will be lost in this one, and you will memorize whether it was insomnia, whether it was swelling here and swelling there. But if you go by the logic of what I'm saying, it will be so easy that you don't have to open your book again. Okay? So that's what I promise. So we'll come back.